Good afternoon, everybody here in the room. If you're online, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are. I'm super thrilled to be here today. My name is Kim Brill, and I oversee global alliances at Microsoft. Specifically, I work with Elastic very closely. And what it means is that my team and I, we oversee many of the motions that drive co-innovation and go-to-market together with Elastic. So I'm super, super thrilled to be here to at least introduce the partnership. We are going to have a jam-packed session for you, and it's going to be vector search is not enough. Hopefully address that question. There's no question mark, but still, we're going to go through that. So Elastic will take you through that. But I'm really excited about today because of three distinct reasons. One being partners make more possible. We firmly believe that at Microsoft. And the second one is that Elastic is going to show you some great content testamenting that. And thirdly, finally, we're also going to hear from a customer of Elastic, Relativity, who also happens to be another global partner of Microsoft. So you're in for a treat, and I hope you will enjoy it. I hope you've enjoyed both so far. With that, I'm thrilled to introduce distinguished architect from Elastic, Dr. Michael Hildebrandt. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim. As you heard, the title of the talk is Vector Search is Not Enough. Just a little bit of housekeeping here. I will be making some forward-looking statements. Long story short of this wonderful wall of text on the slide written by the lawyers is don't make any future buying decisions based on products that are not, or features that are not GA. Go ahead and make your purchasing decision based on what's available today. So I've told you vector search isn't enough, but maybe we should talk about a little bit about what is a vector search. So vector search 101, at a high level, when you're used to searching documents or putting things in a search box, and you put all the right things in there. In this example, we have connection speed requirements. And you can see in the search box and in the document, we have basically a one-to-one match. We're going to find those. Vector search is the way that we're also going to be able to find when something in the search box is high-speed internet, things like that, where it's not connection speed requirements, not exactly, but like, is my connection fast enough for things like that? The words may not all be there, but we're semantically going to actually get the meaning of the query and semantically know the meaning of the document and be able to find these things together, even if it's not a perfect match. And so whether this works at a kind of a simplistic level is that we work on dimensionality. There's different dimensions of data. And so in this case, we've got an example with one dimension here. If we think about an elk, we have a realistic looking elk over there. We have a cartoony looking elk. And if we start adding in additional dimensions, we'll stop with two here to not make it too crazy. But if we think about between mammal and bird, you can see we have a cartoony owl on the bottom right. Our upper right is our cartoony elk, upper left, realistic elk, lower left is our realistic owl. And if you think about putting more and more information into this space, you can see that basically where you point in this dimensional space, you're going to find similar data is going to be in a similar place together. So this is the embedding space. When you search, you're also going to basically bring your query, and your query is going to have to be embedded into the same space as well. So you can see that the ranking of the documents by vector search here indicate that we have an exact match for our query. There is an elk at a desk holding up a piece of paper. So we have a perfect match. So that is our number one result. You can see results 2 and 3 are actually very close to that elk. They are cartoony elks in the upper right. Down as you get a little bit further down, we've got an elk with wings. So we're not quite sure. It's maybe more bird than elk, or who knows, wherever you want to draw this. But it's basically the next one, and it's a little bit further away. You go over then to the owl and all the way over, because again, even though it's a wild swing, it's actually the closest thing when you calculate the distance between the vectors to go all the way up to the realistic looking elk. And so it's basically just math, 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 and math. When you're doing vector search, in the real world and actually doing it, you're not working with two dimensions. You're working at like 384 dimensions, 512, 1,024 different dimensions to describe the data. So again, it's kind of well beyond what you want to think about as a human. We let the computers do all the calculations for us. So conceptually, if you're going to do vector search at scale, you're going to need a place to basically store for all of your source data, whether that's images, documents, audio, really anything you can think of. You can find a way to turn those into vectors and do that with a repeatable process. And then you're going to end up with basically a database full of vectors. On the right-hand side, you're going to see that you've got queries. And again, you have to do the same process. You need to embed those queries into that same vector space so you can then do that computation to figure out what is the best result to return to our users. So again, Elasticsearch as a vector database is something to embed your queries into vectors, do those comparisons. We're an end-to-end solution for that for you. So again, I mentioned you're going to be working with 1,024 dimensions of data, of floating point numbers or integers and things like that. It's a lot of math to do it. Nobody actually wants to sit down and type it out by hand. So obviously, there's got to be a way to do this. And the way we do this is this thing called embeddings. And embeddings allow you to basically bring your data to the cluster for us when we're talking about text, run it through a model, and then the output of this is going to be a number of different vectors that you can then use for vector search. So again, where do these come from? There's many, many, many different models out there. I'm just highlighting one particular one, not necessarily an endorsement. But this is an example from Google where they did the bidirectional encoder representations for transforms, which is a long, long thing to say. So they call it BERT models. And for those that don't know, there's a whole lot of Sesame Street jokes lurking around out there. There's an Elmo and things like that. So people go wild when you have a theme like that to run with. And so there's all sorts of different BERT models. And the reason there are so many different BERT models is that they were designed to be trained in layers. So like the really hard stuff of teaching the computer that doesn't know anything about language, that base layer of the model, was like years of GPU time. Kind of really expensive to train that base model. But BERT's built in such a way that you can actually take a BERT model and fine-tune it in just an hour or so on a single GPU. You can take it to your data and train it to do a task specifically and make it very optimal for what you want to do with it. So again, that's the real power of the BERT models, and that's why there's so many derivatives of them, is that everybody's trained them to do different things. So for Elastic, vector search is a key starting point for us. How did we get here? So let's talk about a little bit of the history of vectors in Elastic. This did not happen overnight. We've continued to invest way back in the beginning. We started 8.0. We released our initial parts of KNN, which is K-nearest neighbor search, i.e. the high-speed searching of vectors. HNSW is the algorithm. I'll get into that in just a minute. But it's not just vectors, and we're going to cover this in depth more. There's also all sorts of other natural language processing that we can do with the same approach. As you walk your way across the timelines, we've hit GAN milestones, and where we are today, and we're going to talk more about it, is the Elastic Sparse Vector Text Expansion Model, which is a different way to do semantic search, and I'll cover in depth in a little bit, and something called Reciprocal Rank Fusion, which is going to make it really easy to basically bring all these things together. So let's jump into that with a little more depth. But first, just a reminder, it's not enough just to store a bunch of vectors, or store a bunch of text and then just, like grep through it. If you're an old sysadmin or just, with brute force, absolutely computationally calculate every single vector in the database. For those that are gamers, the reason that your GPU is so hot is that you're doing all these calculations all the time. It's the same kind of computational pain to do that at speed and scale. So we've actually got to, index it to make it fast. And just as a reminder, when you think of us as a search engine, when we're talking about kind of a wall of text, what we do is a process of analysis where we basically take your text, we tokenize it, and then from this list of tokens, we then build an inverted index. So you can see in this example, we have three documents. Is very common. It's in documents 1, 2, and 3, but winter is only in document 1, for example. We build this, with the postings and the positions and things like this, so we can do all the things that you're used to as a search engine. We can tell you what the most relevant documents are. We can find phrases of tokens next to each other, so on and so forth. And we use BM25, which is basically an improvement to TF-IDF for term frequency, inverse document frequency. I used to just think of BM25 as a search algorithm until the data scientists actually informed me that no, it is actually a sparse, unsupervised model for lexical search. So you have to, if you think like a data scientist, it is actually a model all on its own. It's just very, very sparse. Think of all those different tokens that you've got. It's a very wide number of things that you can basically place your tokens into. When we're talking about other types of data, like numeric and geospatial, we actually use a different approach, and that's a block KD tree, which is where even if it's a singular number, it's actually indexed as a vector so that you can search for it in this kind of vector space. But interestingly enough, when you want to do vector search, you actually use a graph. And again, this is an approach called hierarchical navigable small worlds, which I encourage you all to try to say quickly and on stage in front of everybody. It's not easy to get out of your mouth, but it is a layered approach that is going to help you really quickly basically walk your way down to the nearest neighbors. And so think of it this way, like when you're scrolling around on a map, you don't zoom into the street level and try and go all the way to the West Coast from where I live in like Minnesota. It's just gonna take you too long for scrolling. You zoom all the way out, you make a big move, and then you zoom in and zoom in, and then you adjust till you find what you're looking for. It's the same general approach. We have to do computations of all the different vectors and figure out at what layers we're gonna populate them into. And so it's very dense at the bottom, but there's a very light set of them at the top so that you can make these big swings and work your way into finding these results. So there's a balance of basically getting a little bit fuzzy on accuracy, but you can go a whole lot faster than looking at every single vector in the database and calculating its distance, for example. So now that we finally got through all of the kind of the building blocks here, again, what is the user experience for vector search? Well, it's exactly the same as it is for any other search. You're just basically doing something behind the scenes for them. In this case, we're taking a query for summer clothes. We are running an embedding model on that summer clothes query, and you are gonna get your documents back out of Elasticsearch. So again, once you've got all those pieces, it's basically just like any other search. The query DSL just looks a tiny bit different than you're used to. But, you know, as I've told you, vector search, you know, isn't enough, and especially alone. Sometimes vector search isn't gonna give you the best or most accurate results. Sometimes the models are not gonna be perfectly tuned for you. So, not to worry. You know, being Elasticsearch, we didn't just chuck BM25 out. You know, it is still there. And you can do hybrid scoring in there, where again, you're going to pass summer clothes in as a regular query. You're going to also do it as a KNN query, and then you're going to blend the results together. And again, you're going to be responsible for figuring out with the boosts there. We're saying in this particular query that we want the vectors to kind of dominate the scoring because we've given them a higher boost. And so you can put those two things together and really blend those results and get the best results that you possibly can for your users. Now, again, but wait, there's more. We're gonna have to add faceting as well. So if you've ever done e-commerce search or anything like that, you've seen the left side populate with all the different counts of the different brands or the attributes and everything. That is dynamically being calculated on the fly based on what you've searched for. And so how do you do that in Elasticsearch? For us, you just add the aggregations to it. So again, if you wanna do a breakdown of the brands that you found with your wide, you know, wide-ranging search, you just add an aggregation to it. So, and again, you also need to think about role-based access control. You may not want everything in your search engine to be visible by everybody. As an example, let's say you've got employee data or something with PII. You're gonna wanna control access to that. And so there's role-based access control in Elasticsearch. For example, a quick example of saying, hey, if you're an employee, you can see just the state and the first name and the last name of the user, for example. You may not want to disclose social security numbers, actual street addresses, and things like that. Role-based access control gives you the ability to basically protect that data and assign different rights and privileges to who uses it. So as I mentioned, you know, we're basically a holistic vector database. You can put vectors in, you can do BM25. It's a great place to get started. We talked about those different models to bring into the cluster. There's not just one, as I mentioned. Elastic makes it easy to actually bring in lots of these different third-party models. As I said, tons of different text embedding ones. You may find one that works perfectly for you, but the only way you're gonna do that is getting all these different models into the system. And so we've got utilities to help load, put them into the system, click a button, and then they become operational for your use. You're also allowed to use your own proprietary models. Again, if you wanna fine-tune that BERT model, if you've got a data science team that wants to develop their own model, you know, there's a good chance we're gonna be able to just easily bring that in just like anything else. We'll talk for a minute, too, about the Elastic Learn Sparse Encoder, which is our out-of-the-box, click a button, it's going to get loaded into your cluster and ready for use. So again, really easy to basically bring these things in. You don't have to stand up any other infrastructure. It's all already in the cluster, so you don't need anything else. Just basically turn it on and get going. There are a lot of different NLP tasks that you can do. Specifically today, we're kind of focusing on vector search, but there's a whole other list of things that you can do. You know, fill mask, named entity recognition, text embedding, which is the vectors, text classification, question answering, zero shot text classification. You know, I don't want to take up the rest of the session reading out all of these to you. So again, if you'd like to scan that QR code, you know, you're more than welcome to take your time to browse through the documentation. And that also reminds me, if you've got any questions, you can scan the QR code over there on the left, and that'll take you to a site where you can start answering questions. My colleague Jeff Vestal over there is there to help answer questions live as they come up. So let's talk a little bit more about this Elastic Learn Sparse Encoder model. This is another way of doing semantic search without using vectors as the way to do the similarity. So again, the same way to do semantic search, the ability to not have exactly what your users type, but without necessarily having to get all those vectors, do that pre-computation for HNSW, and some of the basically the tuning that needs to go into it for a high-speed vector search. This allows us to basically kind of sidestep that a little bit, get the semantic search, but play exactly to the strengths of where Elasticsearch plays really well, you know, an on-disk term-based search engine. The most important thing about this is that not only is it, you know, basically easy to use, it's also basically got the best-in-class performance right now. So that's really important because you don't need to tune it. So we'll cover that in just a minute. Some of the things that have been a drawback to doing vector search is that, you know, you've got to get expertise and resources to fine-tune these BERT models to get really good scores, because again, the ones that are up there may not be the easiest ones for you to get. For ours, you know, if it's out of domain, you know, again, the model's never seen data like that before, it's still going to be working out of the box. And it just kind of solves that vocabulary mismatch problem, where again, you need that semantic search, but you need an easy way to do it without a data science team. Another nice thing about it is actually much more interpretable than dense vector. As I mentioned, looking at 1,024 numbers is not going to help me figure out exactly why this result's there. The way that this one works, it's actually going to give you a list of basically, it causes document expansion, so you're going to get a list of words, and then it's going to give you a bunch of other words that it could also mean. So that's how it's doing the semantic search. So you can actually see what it thought the meaning of the document was. So again, you can interpret that as a human. The best part is it's currently outperforming Splayed, which is another sparse encoder model, and which is the previous champ. You saw those great animations on the last slide. That was made by our marketing department. This slide was made by our data scientists, so it's a little bit of an eye chart. But I want you to focus on the top line and the bottom line. The top line is BM25, which I believe a couple of months ago somebody had declared that, you know, BM25 search was dead. Well, it's not. BM25 plus our sparse learned encoder model, I want you to focus on all the green. It basically wins in every challenge that we throw it at. And the worst it did is that it basically used BM25 as a floor to make sure that that touche 2020. So it didn't lose in any case. It only got better each time. And again, you can take your time to review this later. But again, out of the box, no data science team. Just bring your data and start using it. It's really, really easy to get great results now. So we've been mentioning we've got BM25, we've got vector search, we've got this new text expansion query. We've got to get a way to get these things all together. And so with just a little bit of hamming it up here, so we've got this thing called reciprocal rank fusion, which is going to allow you to basically take all these different rating systems that you've got, the BM25 vector. And normally, if you had to do this with trying to get the scores, matched up, you can see that algorithm one tops out at a one, algorithm two is 1,000. You could tear your hair out trying to get everything normalized and linearized so that you can get the right stack rank between those. But, why bother? We have this thing called RRF now, and it's basically going to look at the ranks that your different documents land in with these different systems and then blend them together for you so that you don't have to do all that hard work of getting everything linearized. Just let things score the way they score, take their ranks, and then get the best results for your users. So we've kind of moved beyond just a standard vector database. Now we're basically a relevance engine as well with AI-powered search. And so I think this is announcing as of either yesterday or today specifically, we have now basically announced this is the Elasticsearch Relevance Engine, and you'll hear it basically referred to as Ezra for short. And this is all the things that you need to basically build the best search experience for your users, whether you want to do straight vector with images or you want to do BM25 and sparse. All of the tools are there for you to do whatever type of search you need. It's all basically put together. This is the kind of the collection of the umbrella of different features that that have actually been a part of Elasticsearch for a really, really, really long time. But we're just kind of really calling out again that it's everything that you need to be a relevance engine. And we don't think you're going to find anything better than Ezra. Nobody got the joke. Sorry, everybody. Yeah, they could look it up later, I guess. All right, so let's talk a little bit about the evolution of how users are going to go ahead. What is the evolution of search experiences? So again, people now are looking for, more questions and answers in their searching. They're asking questions of search engines. They want answers from that. People expect to be able to do image searching. People expect to be able to get personalized results. We didn't cover this in depth, but again, another one of the things that Elastic can do is actually rescore on those dense vectors and basically do personalization as an additive or a layer on all of these other things that we find documents. We can personalize based on user vectors and product vectors. We can then rescore those for personalization. So sentiment analysis as well, part of that NLP suite of utilities. You know, the ability to know, are your users having a good experience, a bad experience? You know, help you figure out positive, negative, and get in there fast if somebody's having a bad experience, for example. So hopefully we've kind of covered why vector search, you know, on its own really isn't enough to basically get this job done of providing the best and most relevant documents to your users. But there's more. This is an example of basically explosive growth where it took Netflix 10 years to get to 100 million users. It's taken ChatGPT approximately like 10 days. So like just amazing, stratospheric adoption by end users. I don't think ChatGPT and OpenAI is a surprise to anyone in the room. It's kind of the theme of the conference here. But what does it open up in terms of our search experiences? You know, we saw some of this in the keynote, but just to kind of like continue on with this, you know, when you're in e-commerce, people have trained themselves to think like the robot. You know, you're putting in different keywords and tokens. You've taken out all the words that make it a question. You know, there's no this, a, the. Those are all gone because you know that those aren't helping you with search. So you've learned to search like this, and it's not the most ideal experience. We want to get to where you just ask a question. And not only is ChatGPT going to know that your location for the store is in Detroit, Michigan, but because you're in Detroit, Michigan, that you've got a lower frost line because it's colder up there, for example. So again, it knows all these details, and then it basically builds your shopping cart for you. Again, you don't need to go pick it all out yourself. You just talk to the search engine. You ask your question, and you get those answers. When we're talking about kind of a workplace search example, again, trying to think like the tokens. 401k policy USA. It's a very broken, you know, if you just send that to somebody, they'd blink at you because it would be a weird thing to say. We want to move to this again where it's like, we want to ask a question. Just speak to the search box. Don't try and like change the way you think. Just ask your questions. Get the answers that you need. So of course, you know, ChatGPT has generated a lot of interest in this area. As we saw, you know, 100 million users in about a week. So how are we all going to make the most of this shift? You know, how do you build with this? And you know, what are some of these challenges? So let's cover those for a second. So there's context windows and costs, and what does that mean? So again, while this model excels at human, you know, iterative-like content creation, it's limited by public training data. Again, I'd be really worried if ChatGPT had my private data. It just had no access to it when it was being trained. So how do we get around that? So these limitations can be done with fine-tuning, which again, you know, I've had a conversation with somebody about, you know, the right time for fine-tuning is when you basically are going to invest a lot of money in the context windows. And again, it's not an easy decision to make. So it is, you know, basically a financially important decision to figure out, am I going to take a large language model and train it myself? The way that most of us are going to deal with this right now is with these question context windows, basically the RAG style search. You're bringing additional information to the chatbot and asking a question so that it's got the context that it needs to make a decision. So these LLMs, many of them are incredibly large. You know, I'd like to call out, you know, the technical achievements that the Azure team had to put together to run basically ChatGPT and their, you know, Azure OpenAI services. For those that don't know, when you're chatting with ChatGPT, 800 GPUs are talking to you. It has a lot of computing resources. This is not going to just kind of run on your laptop, for example. So Monocal, it's a great technical achievement, what they can do. So let's just do a quick example on pricing. You know, you can go check out the pricing for OpenAI. You know, there's multiple models, so on and so forth. And if you think, you know, this paragraph of words on the slide is about 30 tokens. So pricing is currently about 0.2 cents for 1,000 tokens. It does not really seem like it's all that much, but let's kind of put this at scale. If you were to feed ChatGPT War and Peace, it took Tolstoy 4 years to write this novel. It's about 500,000 plus words. It's about 3 megabytes in size on disk. Total retail price, $1.56 to have ChatGPT read it and give you a book report. The problem that we've got is that we generate a lot more data than that every day. Daily human information volume is over 300 million terabytes a day. Retail price, 170 trillion. To ask ChatGPT what happened on the internet today. Anyone have a credit card I can borrow? I'd like to know what happened. No? All right. So obviously it's financially infeasible for us to basically feed everything that we have to these large language models to help us out. So we've got to be really, really selective. And so this is where we want to state that, you know, Elasticsearch and generative AI together is actually the right blend. So what does that look like? Conceptually, you're going to ask your same question that we're talking about, this natural language, speak to the search engine. Because we can perform this semantic search, we can have all of these different document repositories, whether it's fast-moving observability data, HR data, whatever you need it to be, your policies, so on and so forth. Just think of all the different information that you've got that's private to your company. Find just what you need to bring to ChatGPT, and then ask it a question about it or a clarifying question now that you've found the documents. So again, this is going to be the right way to blend these things together and get the right results for our users. I'm going to go ahead and jump over to a demo real quick and show you what one of these actually looks like. So as a quick example, what we did is here at Elastic, we actually crawled all of the different conference abstracts and vectorized them. And I'm going to ask it a question about, you know, vector search use cases. And then what I'm going to ask is ChatGPT to actually read all of the abstracts for me and let me know what technologies will I learn from the sessions. And so our search is running right now, and you know, no surprise, vector search isn't enough as the top vector search use case hit. You know, no sneakiness there on our part. It just matches the best. But you can see the results for asking it, what are you going to learn about? You're going to learn about generative AI, Elasticsearch, and the Microsoft Azure OpenAI service. Again, when I asked it to look at all the different results, we can get this kind of like high-level summary. So again, think, you know, I may have had 8 pages of stuff to read, but now, you know, if you're a busy developer, you need to know what you're going to learn. You can now ask this, you know, generative AI to help summarize these documents for you, you know, help you make decisions, you know, be that artificial intelligence that you need to be smarter. Another thing to note is that, you know, as we covered the cost of running the demo, so far I'm running at about 0.224 cents. So again, we'll put a tip jar out if anyone can give me a penny to run the demo, just to show you we have real-time tracking of what we're doing with when we're actually talking to these LLMs that can cost you a lot of money. So, you know, we're an observability company as well. You know, stop by our room in 321, be happy to continue the story. And of course, you know, we also do APM and all sorts of other stuff. So again, we are tracking, you know, every little bit of this microservice that we put together, what it's talking to, its response times, and things like that. So again, part of the story of Elastic. Let's go ahead back to the deck, please. Where we're going to be going in the future, and again, you saw this in the keynote yesterday, is basically giving the power to the chatbots to be able to go get information that they don't have, that they know they need, because they understand that. So in the very near future, if not maybe even tomorrow, you'll be able to ask these, you know, assistants, you know, your co-pilots, you know, when is my next holiday? And it's going to know, well, I need to go figure out who you are, where you work, what country, and then what's the right policy. Once it's got that information, it can summarize it, just like you saw there in the demo, and basically answer that question for you until next one's going to be Memorial Day for the United States, for an example. So again, that future is not that far off. So again, this is all built on all the investments that we've made. You saw the timeline. We don't really, you know, we never stop trying to innovate and add features. But where we are now, we've got vector search, these native transformer models, and the ability to have this sophisticated relevance ranking. So you saw that all today. Again, we are proven at scale. We're enterprise ready, and we're really flexible. If you want to run us at Azure, you can. If you want to run us in another cloud, you can. If you want to run us on premises, you can. Elasticsearch can go wherever you need it to go, including air-gapped environments. So with that, I've kind of summarized, you know, in summary, I've kind of finished my portion of the talk. But now, what I want to do is hand this off to Brittany Rausch from Relativity, who is going to talk to you about, you know, not just conceptual stuff, but kind of where they're going to be going and taking the technologies that we talked about today to the next level in their product. Brittany?
Thank you. All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me here at Build. It's a real honor to be here. My name is Brittany Rausch. I'm a senior product manager at Relativity. For those of you who don't know what Relativity is or who we're a legal technology provider specializing in data discovery for litigation and investigations. So just as some background, in a legal dispute, counsel has an obligation to collect, preserve, identify, and ultimately share data with the opposing party. In litigation, we call this e-discovery, and it's key to fact-finding and to building case strategy. In investigations, data discovery is exactly what it sounds like. You're looking for evidence to build your case. So, too long didn't read, we help legal teams do 3 things: organize data, discover the truth, and act on it. That's literally our mission. And so you probably haven't heard of us, but you do see the results of work done in our platform every single day. And so we can't do this work alone. a major reason why Relativity is the data discovery solution is because of the huge emphasis we've put on our vibrant user and partner community. So we're really excited to be here today with Microsoft, Azure OpenAI, and Elastic, because they're all helping us discover the truth and helping our customers discover the truth. And what I think is really special about Relativity relationships is that they go far beyond the product. Microsoft, for example, supports our Justice for Change program. Justice for Change provides our SaaS solution, Relativity One, free to organizations working on legal cases that address social and justice change issues. And the program's making a difference. Just this year, the Hawaii Innocence Project was able to use Relativity to secure the exoneration of Ian Schweitzer, wrongfully convicted of murder 25 years ago. Over 30 nonprofits and law firms use our technology to take on pro bono matters that address injustices like these. And so collaborating on something that makes a difference in the world is something we're really excited about and we're really proud of. And so we're always on the lookout for powerful technology that can help our customers do more with less. So one of the biggest problems facing our customers right now is the data growth explosion and the myriads of different file types and applications that a user might be encountering in their day-to-day. And then compounding that problem is that you don't talk the same way across all the applications. Like, you're probably not emailing the same way you text. I hope not. And so keyword searching, which is the foundation of e-discovery, just isn't always the most effective way to look for information in a data set. So with Ezra, we see the potential to deliver a search experience that goes beyond keyword searching and basic conceptual searching. We see an opportunity to natively tailor search to the case data and build on-the-fly vectorization to customize that experience for our users. We see a search experience that's augmented by numerous AI capabilities, such as GPT-4, signal detection, different kinds of classification and prompt models, and our own in-house AI solutions. And so what the goal is that what takes months, hours, years sometimes, for our investigators and legal teams to do, we want to bring down into hours and minutes. But seeing is believing, so I'm going to show you how these possibilities may come to life. To do that, I'm going to walk through a case that's based off of something we might see in our Justice for Change program. So picture this. You're an investigator at the EEOC. You've just been presented with a case of two undocumented immigrants who were fired and then deported. The case revolves around Big Thorium. This is a made-up company. Everything you see here has been generated with DALL-E to bring in some fun AI. And Big Thorium is an energy provider, and they put out a call for workers to help build their new power plant in Texas. A local recruiter offered the two employees a spot on the crew. They had to pay the upfront processing costs, so they sold their homes, they paid $20,000 in fees, and they went to America. But a month later, they found themselves relocated to flimsy barracks, segregated from other workers, under armed guard and with a fence separating them. And they have to pay to live in those barracks. The green cards they were promised turned out to be temporary work visas. They'd leave, but management is holding on to their passports. They garnish their wages, and they intimate physical violence if they continue to complain. Two employees discuss whistleblowing on Slack, but they didn't realize that they were being monitored, and the company fires them and deports them. And so while this hypothetical sounds outlandish and horrible, it's actually based off of a case that's very real, it's happening right now, and it's being litigated by the ACLU. And so this is the type of work that our customers do every day, and our job at Relativity is to make this work possible. So in the Big Thorium case, if we go back to our example, there are over 50,000 documents that we need to whittle down to just those that are potentially relevant. But how do we get started? And so investigators often find themselves at the base of a mountain of data with a whole bunch of different ways to get to the top. And at Relativity, our job is to give them a signpost of how to get to the top in the quickest, most efficient way possible. And so we do that using technologies like Ezra, GPT-4, our own fit-for-purpose sentiment analysis tool, and signal detection. And so then there's the wrinkle in the case of not knowing what we don't know. Investigators usually start out their cases with very little known facts. And so it can be hard to figure out what's a rabbit hole that has no end to it, or what's a valuable lead that you should pull the thread on. And so using Ezra, we can automatically pick up more of those metaphorical signposts along the way and put them in the investigator's path. And so we can interrogate the data, and we can identify documents with a question or with different conceptual concepts. And we can dig into those related concepts. So in this example, we see that the engine identifies that withholding pay is related to documents that contain employee retaliation type language. And if I'm an investigator, that's exactly the kind of signal I want to pick up. And so if I drill down into those documents, and it kind of went too fast, but you could see that the document was talking about withholding pay. And so this is what we would call our smoking gun. Not always this easy, but it does happen. And so in the few minutes we have left, we should probably address the elephant in the room, or the mountain. This is no Punic War illusions here. My creative director insisted on metaphorical consistency, so that's why we have that. So if you're like me, you've sat through this last like 6-7 minutes, and you're really excited about the possibilities of AI, but you're also terrified of what the future might look like if we inject AI into the legal process. We get it. You're not alone. At Relativity, we think and talk about this a lot, constantly. We're hyper aware of the responsibility that we and our partners have to get this right. You know, fair outcomes in the justice system is no small matter. And so just last week, we published our AI principles to guide a framework of accountability within our organization so that we never lose sight of what really matters, which is the people that are impacted by the signals and the insights that we pull out of the document set. And our principles are centered around fairness and accountability. It's not only our obligation to provide customers with security, privacy, and control over their data, but it's our obligation to build transparent, understandable, fit-for-purpose AI tools that can scale and treat people, all people, fairly. And so it's not just enough to publish these principles, we have to put them into action. And so we do this in a number of different ways. And for the sake of time, I'll go through two examples. So we put the models that we build or that we purchase through rigorous bias training, ensuring that we're focused on limiting harm to marginalized groups of people and providing transparency in our models through white papers, blogs, videos, training, and so forth. And then we carefully consider the legal and ethical ramifications of any product that we build. So we ask ourselves, what harm can this cause if a bad actor gets a hold of this technology, or if somebody with really good intentions just inadvertently misuses the product? And so we think about if we should build something and deploy it, rather than if we can build something and deploy it. And so we have to be immensely responsible with the decisions that we're making regarding technology and our platform. And we believe that with the principles and technologies like Ezra, we can help our customers solve their problems in a meaningful way. But we aren't losing sight of the risks that come across or along with that. And so a colleague recently told me that he's cautious, but optimistic and hopeful about the future of AI in our industry and in Relativity, and I am too. So thank you, Michael and Elastic and Microsoft, for allowing us to talk about this. So I think we have time to take a few questions.
Yeah. All right, we have a question. Is vector and hybrid search available for preview, or is there a wait list? The short answer to that is that as of, I think, tomorrow, everything's going to be released in our 8.8 version, so you'll be able to start using it as a technology preview. For the hybrid search and vector search actually has been available. The Elastic Learn Sparse Encoder model will show up as a tech preview basically tomorrow. But all the other things that we talked about for hybrid search are available today. I don't know if that scrolls or not, so there's a second one we can cover. but I can't read the whole question. Nope. Ah, there we go. All right, there's another question. When is vector search a better choice than the Elasticlearn sparse encoder? The answer to that one, in short, is gonna be when there is no language that we basically have to work with. So when you think image search, we're basically only in the world of vectors. So there's gonna be a clear choice there when we don't have basically language. Now, if you converted that image into a descriptive paragraph using a large language model, for example, describing what's going on, we may be in actually a pretty good shootout between is a pure vector search or is the sparse encoder model gonna work. The best part is that you can run both at the same time and run reciprocal rank fusion on them and get the best results. So again, you don't have to make an either or choice. It's a yes and choice. There's another question. Does Elasticsearch plan to support dimensions greater than 1,024? I've got great news for you. On that roadmap slide coming out as of tomorrow, we are going to go all the way up to 2,048 dimensions for being able to do k-nearest neighbor searches. So the answer is yes. I'll let the engineers know. All right, is that it for questions?
Any questions in the room?
Yeah. Any questions in the room? Yes.
So yesterday at the keynote, we had that amazing the Westlaw Copilot thing.
Mm-hmm.
I just made that word up.
Nope.
Is your company going to have anything similar like that, or is it more of an engagement service? Or?
Yeah. So
we're the question real quick, just so because not everyone's back. The question was: is there going to be similar things for the Westlaw Copilot coming for Relativity?
Yeah, so Relativity has a contracts platform called Heretic that we include as part of our platform, obviously. So we will probably be looking into that. I'm not that product manager, so unfortunately I can't get too detailed, but we can certainly chat about it afterwards. Any other questions? We've got 3 minutes left.
And I've got two more slides.
Oh. Go for it.
So again, we're kind of fishing. Any other questions in the room? So this is your chance. If not, you can come visit us, Elastics in room 321, just downstairs, if you want to come continue the conversation. We'll be here all the way till the end of the conference here. And with that, I'll just kind of, like I said, finish up on my last few slides. So again, we've talked a lot about, you know, machine learning in the context of search, but machine learning is also applicable to our other core use cases, our other core solutions of, you know, security and observability, as well as basically helping data scientists build custom models. Again, a lot of that work, you want to get data as fast as possible for when you're building custom things. You know, don't hesitate to let Elasticsearch help you on that journey. Observability-wise, you know, we've got things all around to help you with anomaly detection, whether unsupervised or training models, you know, AI ops and things like that. And security, you know, a lot of the way that we help find threats is by looking for anomalies in the data. So again, machine learning is applicable to all of the different types of data and the use cases that we handle. And with that, you know, don't think that you know, we're just specific to any one particular, you know, business. You can see the broad adoption by our developers in basically every single vertical that we have out there. And I've been at Elastic long enough to have the pleasure of actually talking to every at least one of these logos in 5 of those 7 columns personally. So I've had a great journey being able to talk to these different teams and help them basically solve their data and their search challenges. So with that, thank you very much for your time, everybody, and have a great day.